Dr. Ayuba from, and please forgive me if I've mispronounced this, Hôpital Necker Enfants Malades in Paris, France.
I am Dr. Achille Ayuba. I have changed my hospital now. I work in Normandy at the hospital University of Caen. I work in internal medicine service department, and I work in especially in laryngeal cell histiocytosis and in Erdheim-Chester disease. I am working essentially in the about anakinra assessment in Erdheim-Chester disease, and now I am trying to conduct a retrospective study to assess the different success of anakinra on each organ, because anakinra can work differently on various organs. And it is important to know the frequencies and the type of organ on which anakinra show its best efficacy. So I propose a retrospective study and I call all patients who have been treated with anakinra to contact the Global Alliance and to participate to the study. It will give me the data to assess the real efficacy of anakinra. And anakinra may also be associated with other drugs. And experiences now, patients who have a good response to verapamil, and but the BRAF mutation was not present on all sites. The patient have gone pericardium and pericardic effusion, and the biopsy find no mutation BRAF on the pleural effusion, but on the pericardium. And vemurafenib works on efficacy on the pericardium, but not on the pleural effusion, and show a severe toxicity. When I combine anakinra and vemurafenib, the patient good complete and good response and. Satisfactory tolerance to this drug. So this study aim also to evaluate which drug have been proposed before anakinra and after anakinra, and eventually the drug that will be associated with this drug. Have you questions? There is a question. Yes.
Yeah, I've been on anakinra for a year and a half, and I had to come off of it because it's lowering my immune response. So I'm wondering, how long can people stay on it?
For much patient, when you stop anakinra, the disease relapse. So our patient, the first person I was treated at anakinra for 10 years without a matter. But when he tried to stop the treatment, the disease relapsed in the mouth. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Next, I would like to introduce Dr. Dania from Milan, Italy.
Thank you very much for this wonderful invitation and for being here today. I will be just quickly reviewing something about the activity at San Raffaele Group. We have created in San Raffaele, since we follow a significant cohort of patients, roughly around 40 patients with the disease, a specific clinic taking care of the different aspects of the Erdheim-Chester disease. And indeed, we have a kind of almost walking clinic once a week for those patients, and we have a number of specialists that are dedicated to this disease, and they take care of the different aspects of the disease and different organ system involvement, or also for this different diagnostic purposes. So, for example, every CT exam is reviewed by the same physician, every MRI is reviewed by the same physician, and so on. And this is extremely interesting because we're having interesting results, and the patient feel quite happy about this way of proceeding. From a research standpoint, our group started the research on Erdheim-Chester disease, showing first that inflammation is linked to the disease. And actually, the inflammatory aspects of the disease are one of the main themes that we are still pursuing. We, of course, follow with great interest the fantastic and extremely emotional discovery of mutation in this disease, and the changes that the use of targeted therapy is making in the pathogen, in the treatment of this disease. But we still keep analyzing the potential effect of other different treatments that could be considered in patients that are not candidate for the targeted disease so far, and that may be considered for adjunctive treatment to this specific new treatment. With the idea to try to understand why some patients do not respond adequately to that treatment, and to try to reach that unmet need for treatment for everyone. And indeed, our research, as I presented some data yesterday, and we are going on with that, is focused to understanding what is the link between this mutation and the inflammation that we see in the disease, and how we can dampen this inflammation trying to really treat and take care of every manifestation of the disease, even in the negative patient or in the patient who not respond adequately to the treatment.
Whatever you're most comfortable with will be fine. All right. Thank you once again, Dr. Danya. Our next presenter will be Dr. Diamond from Memorial Sloan Kettering.
Hi, everyone. Good morning. It's nice to be here. We have a big clinical and research effort for ECD at Sloan Kettering that involves me and then several other specialists. We have four or five research studies of different varieties that I want to tell you about. The first is what's just called a biospecimen protocol, and that means for any ECD patient who comes to see me, you agree that if we take blood, we take urine, we take a biopsy, whatever it is, what's left over or extra can be used for research. And I would say that a lot of what we have been able to do in terms of discoveries about non-BRAF mutations in ECD has come from people who have signed a biospecimen protocol. So it's more important than I can ever emphasize. So anyone who can do it, I think it may help you, and it may help everyone else. So that's number one. We have a study that will be opening in a few weeks to help improve the accuracy of diagnostic biopsies in ECD. I'm sure many people in the room may have had the frustrating experience of having 4, 5, 6, 7, if not more, biopsies until they got the correct answer of ECD. So there's a new kind of PET imaging that we're doing a pilot study of. So patients who need a biopsy for one reason or another, whether it's to be diagnosed or before participating in a trial, they'll have a regular PET scan and one of these research PET scans. And together with the two kinds of PET scans, we'll do a biopsy of two different sites And then we will find out whether this new kind of PET scan actually allows you to have a more accurate biopsy than the imaging that we have currently. And I think everyone knows that that's imperfect, to say the least. So that's number two. Number three, most exciting, is we're opening a new clinical trial for the BRAF negative patients. And that will be a drug called cobimetinib, or a MEK inhibitor. This is a drug that targets the whole pathway that the mutations in ECD are found in. That will be opening in the next month or so. It's going to start, for the foreseeable future, only at MSK. So that has its, at Sloan Kettering, that has its inconveniences. I've made the eligibility of the trial really as loose as possible, so that the only reason someone can't participate is because you'd anticipate the drug will really make them sick. Exclusions that are kind of, you know, willy-nilly and sort of the normal fodder of regular trials, I've really tried to minimize those. So it should be as inclusive as possible. That was three. Number four, we're going to be doing a study about brain function in Erdheim-Chester patients. I'm going to be talking a little bit about the brain later today, but I think problems with concentration and memory are very common among you guys. So this is really volunteering on your part to get some extra brain MRIs, spend a little bit more time in the scanner when you come for a scan, do some thinking and memory testing, and help us sort out exactly what kinds of difficulties you guys have and maybe try to figure out why. And then the last, which there'll be more information about later, is we're going to be starting a registry, which will be sort of a big sort of living database about you and about your disease, what treatments work, and your quality of life and what's important to you. So those are what's going on in our camp. Okay? Any questions? New York City. Okay, I'll be around.
Thank you, Dr. Diamond. Following Dr. Diamond, we have Dr. Stradivarius. Welcome him back to the stage.
Well, hello again. So, the NIH, we have two studies. I'm going to start describing the natural history study, which is official title is Clinical and Basic Investigations into Erdheim-Chester Disease. At this point, we have 57 patients that have been seen in the clinic or in the inpatient unit, and also we have some patients that are not able to make it to the NIH because their clinical situation doesn't allow them to travel, or they live in a part of the world that is not feasible for them to come to the NIH. So those patients sign the consent form for something similar to the biospecimen trial at NIH. We allow them to send us their blood, their paraffin blocks, their frozen tissue, or anything, and we can do BRAF testing for them. And then we can share that sample with Sloan Kettering or with other institutions that we have a material travel agreement already in place. So when I say natural history studies, now that you come and we get information from you and we see you next year, we bring the patients on a Sunday and they are discharged on a Saturday. They spend the whole week in the NIH main campus, and we allow them to bring one family member. And when I say allow them, it's that the NIH covers the travel to Bethesda and also covers the lodging. There are exceptions to the rules, specifically when it's international patients or when there are families that they need more than two caregivers to take care of the patient. So those are exceptions that Mr. Jose Salas knows all the rules about, and he's our, visit coordinator. The week entails evaluations by the rehabilitation medicine team that includes occupational therapy, physical therapy, and the evaluations of a physiatrist. They see dental clinic, neuroophthalmology, dermatology, and neurology, all the specialties that basically have to do with ECD. We know that the disease affects every part of the body from head to toe, so we make sure that every patient sees the same specialist, whether they have disease in the kidney or not, for example, so we can have a good comparison. Imaging, we put the patients in the scanner to get chest CT and cardiac CT. We also get abdominal MRI, pelvic MRI, brain MRI, orbital MRI, pituitary MRI, whole body PET scan from head to toe, including brain, thorax and extremities, whole body bone scan. And then there are other nuclear medicine tests that we can add as needed. So all this is the information that we gather. So the main title of the study is clinical and basic investigations, but within that consent form, there are also all many little studies going on through the different specialties. For example, the information that Susan Robertson presented yesterday, it was an effort from patients that came to the NIH on the natural history study, and she was able to get this data from them, and the models of the adaptation came from that. All the efforts that cardiology is doing, it's from patients that are coming through the natural history study. So I will be focusing on probably writing a big paper with all the science symptoms and update of everything that's going on, but every specialist has its own little project. Like we have neurology thinking about something, and we have the ophthalmologist thinking about this, dermatology thinking about that, and they all do their own little thing, and then they report to me. So this study is open to everyone that can make it to the NIH, and also that can make it by donating tissue. And we don't have any limits right now of how many times we can see them. Usually the plan is to see them at least once a year or once every 2 years, depending on their condition. But at this point, we are so behind schedule that we owe follow-up to some patients already, because it's just me and Kevin O'Brien seeing the patients. So we are a little bit behind in some follow-ups. And some more patients that have been at the NIH are waiting to get their follow-up appointments and have been behind in answering that back. The other study that we have is the phase 2 trial using dabrafenib and trametinib. We started the trial in January this year. We have evaluated 8 patients, and we have been able to start drug on 5 patients. And I think of those 5 patients, 3 of them are here, and you can ask them any questions you want. I'm not allowed to discuss what's happening, but they can say whatever they want. The trial entails at least 7 visits to the NIH, and the travel is also covered by the study, and the lodging for the family members is also covered by the study. The first visit is a 2 to 3 week visit to the NIH. We first have to do the baseline evaluation, basically make sure that you meet all the inclusions and exclusion criteria, and we do have a really extensive list of inclusions and exclusion criteria, and at some point I've been saying that if I get ECD tomorrow, I might not be a candidate for the trial. So we have a week of evaluations and testing. We have to adapt the RECIST criteria to it, and we need to find that lesion that we have to monitor. And we have rejected 2 patients because they don't have large lesions to follow in a scan or in the skin. And 1 patient we have to reject because he had untreated severe coronary artery disease and also evidence of myocardial infarction in the functional cardiac MRI. Like they were saying about how many patients we need to have in order to have a good statistical output. Right now, this trial is designed to see 18 patients, but since we're being monitored by NCI, FDA, and the NIH Clinical Center, we need to submit information of 6 patients after they have finished at least 4 cycles of therapy, and then they will look at the toxicity level. There are less side effects, like Dr. Yanku was saying, and we need to adjust the dosing maybe. Some patients don't need the whole 150 milligrams of dabrafenib and 2 of trametinib. They might need less than that. So we're thinking about how the drugs are affecting the patient in the toxicity side and how it's improving, and do they need a different dose? So we have to wait for, have that information from the first 6 to continue recruitment, but we are open up to 18, and depending on how positive the results are, we can increase the number to 36, to 40, or anything. So at this point, there is no end. Every patient that comes to the phase 2 trial gets also automatically enrolled in the natural history study, because when we stop drug, we follow them for 3 more months, but yet we don't know what's going to be the follow-up, if they're going to continue drug after that, if it's working well with them or what. But if they're enrolled in the natural history study, we can bring them back for follow-up, and we can follow them through the natural history study. So those are the 2 studies in a nutshell. There's more information about it. Those are interesting. Kevin O'Brien is going to be taking their names. And if you have a pending appointment for the natural history study follow-up, get on the list, because those are the ones first come, first serve for next year. And I'm here for questions. Okay.
Thank you, Dr. Estrada-Varas. Next, we will have Dr. Haroche from Paris, France. If you could please join us.
Hello, everybody. So I'm trying to think of what I'm going to tell you. So I intend to keep on seeing patients with ECD, obviously, and LCH as well, and try to keep on treating patients with BRAF inhibitors and probably MEK inhibitors like cobimetinib, as we have tried to treat some patients who do not have the BRAF mutations in the last couple of weeks and months. And so now we have been treating more than 40 patients with BRAF inhibitors so far. So we have some good results and exciting results, as we have shown and discussed yesterday. And so the idea is to try to treat as many patients as possible, and perhaps to build a trial a little bit like Eli has been doing in Sloan Kettering, and to do this on the European side of the other side of the ocean. Anyway, because it's a bit complicated for patients from the U.S. to come to France, and the contrary is true as well. So I guess we have to set up clinical trials and to try to have a little bit the same strategy of clinical treatments with the patients who live in Europe. So basically, that's it. I guess it most of the thing we want to do is regarding treatments in France and in Europe as well. And so I can take any questions if you have. So far, two. It's just cobimetinib, yeah. And it's and I think the other thing that seems very interesting is the NIH protocol, and to try to get the association of the BRAF inhibitor and MEK inhibitor is probably an option for the future with more active drug and less side effects. So I think that's also an important thing we would like to do. But it's a bit complicated with the European agency, and try to get the right to treat patients. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Haroche. Next, let's welcome Dr. Jacobson from Dana-Farber Cancer Institute in Boston, Massachusetts. Dr. Jacobson?
Thank you for having me today. Through the course of this symposium, we've heard about a number of very specific targeted therapies, thankfully, that have been developed in ECD. If any of my colleagues from Dana-Farber were here, they would tell you you can always kind of me to dumb things down. So my study actually involves a somewhat less targeted agent and a class of drugs called immunomodulatory agents. The drug is called lenalidomide, which has been approved by the FDA to treat a number of blood-related cancers, and we've worked with it for quite some time. The mechanism of lenalidomide is still relatively poorly understood, but it's thought to affect a number of inflammatory and genetic pathways that may be relevant to a number of histiocyte disorders, including ECD. In fact, Dr. McLean published about 7 or 8 years ago a study of a drug called thalidomide, which is a predecessor to lenalidomide, and that drug showed good activity in a related disease called Langerhans histiocytosis, although its utility was somewhat limited by side effects. So lenalidomide is a more potent drug than thalidomide and does not have some of the side effects that thalidomide may have. So our effort is open to everybody. We didn't restrict it to certain BRAF or other molecular signatures, although I think if you do have a BRAF mutation, I would prioritize one of the trials that Eli or other investigators have mentioned. The drug is taken orally. The study is only open in Boston, so it would require some travel to Boston in order to participate. And we have a number of collaborative efforts with colleagues in the lab, as well as colleagues in nursing and neuropsychology, to look at other factors that go along with this treatment. So we are performing genetic profiling on previously obtained samples. We're also obtaining genetic profiling from blood and urine samples. I'm working with one of my colleagues, Donna Berry, who has developed a questionnaire called ESRA-C, which is used widely in cancer. It is really a global measurement of someone's quality of life and physical function, both before, on, and after cancer treatment. So there will be a number of questionnaires. And then if anyone is really bold and really altruistic, I am working with colleagues at MIT in generating mouse models of various diseases, and we're trying to create new mouse models in histiocyte disorders. That does require a fresh biopsy, which obviously limits its utility, but particularly if people have skin involvement, that's generally relatively non-invasive to obtain a sample. And in fact, we've had the best growth in mice from biopsies that are done from the skin. That's completely optional. It's not required to participate in the study. You do get an extra gold star if you do that, and we certainly appreciate it. I can't compete with Paris, but I think Eli will admit also that Boston is a superior city to New York, so that's another bonus of our trial. Ma'am. Done. So we literally take the biopsy, have some poor college student or medical student run it from the clinic to the lab, and it's implanted in the mouse usually within hours. It can be stored for 24 hours at room temperature, but not beyond that. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Jacobson. Now we're going to welcome back Dr. Yang Ku.
So at Anderson, we have actually decided to focus on two major directions in research of Erdheim-Chester disease. One is diagnostic, and so we actually try to identify some other materials, how to diagnose or how to investigate molecular profile of Erdheim-Chester disease from materials other than biopsies, because we had really quite a lot of problems sometimes to do the molecular studies from the biopsies. I mean, the biopsies, especially bone biopsies, are difficult to get a good DNA from. I mean, often you deal with like a lot of stroma and clusters of histiocytes, which really makes difficult to get a good quality DNA for molecular analysis such as BRAF mutation. And it is actually critical because, I mean, when we go back to BRAF inhibitors, I mean, there is a possibility that if you don't have BRAF mutation and you go on BRAF inhibitors, that it actually might make situation even worse. So it's kind of a really targeted therapy. Should you have mutation, that's a good thing. You can go on therapy. But, I mean, if you don't have mutation, you actually absolutely shouldn't. So we use actually an approach which is called liquid biopsies. When we isolate, tumors are actually known to shed some DNA into circulation, and that DNA from circulation is actually capable of getting to even urine. So we are actually trying to get this cancer DNA from blood and from urine and actually use that for multiple purposes, for the diagnosis itself, to detect underlying mutations, for also monitoring of the disease, because the monitoring of the effect of therapy is not always straightforward. I mean, especially in patients in whom the PET scans are not much helpful, you kind of have very little tools how to monitor whether your treatment is working, except for actually looking after the symptoms. And so these are the indications which we are looking at. On the therapeutic side, I mean, what I do for a living mainly is actually to develop new medicines for cancer patients, and I run quite a few phase one clinical trials for patients with cancer. So, I mean, my mission is to make these trials available to patients with Erdheim-Chester disease and histiocytic disorders as well. And I think, as I said in my previous talk, the climate is changing. So I think here on the spot, I can probably think of at least 4 or 5 or 6 trials which would be available to Erdheim-Chester patients, if we believe it's a good alternative for these specific patients, starting with BRAF inhibitors, starting with inhibitors which are more downstream in the pathway, such as ERK inhibitors, or even with approaches such as immunomodulatory approaches combining lenalidomide with immunotherapy, or approaches combining anakinra with mTOR inhibitors such as everolimus, which is a kind of a cousin drug to sirolimus, which Dr. Valio just recently published in Blood as the first clinical trial ever published in ECD. So I think that's probably in a nutshell what we do.
Thank you, Dr. Yanku and Dr. McLean, if you could join us, please.
As others have mentioned, having a robust protocol for obtaining specimens for molecular studies is a very important part of what we do. And for a number of years, we've been gathering blood, urine, CSF, and biopsy specimens from our patients. And these are like gold to us. They're really important in helping us define the molecular characteristics of the histiocytic diseases. So any patient who comes to my clinic, I offer the opportunity to enroll in that and to donate specimens to us. We are offering our Erdheim-Chester patients any of the therapies that you've heard about, but we are also working with Plexicon and Roche to develop clinical trials for the MEK and ERK inhibitors as they come along. And some of these are quite new, and they're just going to be available in the very near future. So I don't have those trials open at this time, but we are hoping to develop them within the next year and offer them to a broad array of patients with the histiocytic diseases. Any questions? Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. McLean. If I could please invite Dr. Vaglio from Parma, Italy, to come up and discuss his studies. Thank you.
Thanks very much. We recently concluded this open-label trial, including 10 patients. The trial was started in the pre-BRAF era, so we didn't have the differentiation between BRAF positive and negative patients. And so we treated 10 patients with the combination of sirolimus and prednisone. And we had good response in about 8 cases. 2 cases had progression of the disease. Then in the same study, we also looked for the protein that is targeted by this drug, that is sirolimus. And this protein is mTOR. mTOR is a protein that is involved in the proliferation of cells, and therefore it can be important also for a proliferating disease such as Erdheim-Chester. And what we actually found is that mTOR is highly expressed in the biopsies, and curiously it's highly expressed exactly in the histiocytes. So we think that for different reasons there might be something that leads to this hyperexpression of mTOR, and this may lead to proliferation and infiltration of tissues. Now that the trial is concluded, and now that we've been seeing very good results with vemurafenib in BRAF-positive patients, we have decided to treat BRAF-positive patients with vemurafenib, whereas we are starting a new series of patients with BRAF negative genotype on everolimus, which is a the brother of sirolimus, it's more manageable in terms of blood levels, so the pharmacokinetics is more advantageous. And so we plan to recruit a few patients in this prospective experience. Based on this mTOR observation, we have been funded by a local foundation, a pilot study, trying to explore what leads to hyperexpression of mTOR. And there's an array, so it's a system that allows to detect multiple genes, the expression of multiple genes that may influence mTOR. And there's an mTOR array that we will run on ECD biopsies. And then we have another laboratory project on PPAR gamma, which is a protein that is involved in lipid metabolism. We know that the histiocytes in Erdheim-Chester, we call them foamy histiocytes because they cytoplasm, so the internal part of the cell is rich in lipids, and we don't know what happens and if this is just their origin, or if there's a genetic or protein defect that makes them abnormal and rich in lipids. And this protein is involved in proliferation of cells and lipid metabolism. And we did a preliminary staining on biopsies, and we found that PPAR gamma, one of the isoforms of PPAR, is expressed in the histiocytes. So we want to continue this project and see if there's an abnormality also in this kind of protein. Thanks.
Thank you, Dr. Vaglio. Now let's welcome Dr. Emil to the stage. He will be discussing his studies.
Good morning. I'm coming from Paris in France. And as you know, France is a very nice country, especially because we have a group of research on histiocytosis. And since many years, we are working on the all histiocytosis. And so we initially started with LCH, which is Langerhans cell histiocytosis, and with Jean Donadieu. And we also work with the group of Pitié-Salpêtrière, and you saw Julien Roche. We have a nice network in France, and we have started a registry in 1993. And at the moment, we have 1,400 patients included, and it's really important because you can have long-term follow-up of the disease, and it's important to see the late complication of the disease. We have also a centralized review, and I'm a pathologist. I'm the guy who look at the microscope, and I'm also the molecular pathologist, the guy who scratched the sample and tried to get some mutation in it. And so we detected some mutation in Erdheim-Chester disease, in BRAF, and in collaboration with the MSKCC group, we also found some other mutations. So I think the centralized review is very important because most of our colleagues, pathologists, they only see one or two cases throughout their life, so it's difficult to make the diagnosis. And since 2010, we have seen 800 samples. So it increases the knowledge just to see the samples and to see the slides, and this is very important. So we receive samples from anywhere in France and outside of France. And we so have the review and the pathology with the molecular pathology on it. So this is one main point, and we are trying to separate some subtypes of histiocytosis and to detect whether all of them are identical. Sometimes it's difficult to make the difference between ECD and Rosai-Dorfman disease. Sometimes it's difficult to see between ECD and LCH. And we with Julien, we showed that several patients with ECD also have LCH lesion. And sometimes it's difficult to make the difference with malignant histiocytosis. And so the more samples we see, the more knowledge we can get on these diseases, on these orphan diseases. We also have different projects which are more basic projects. And we think that there is a common progenitor, progenitor cells for ECD and LCH. So we are trying to see within the bone marrow cells and whether we can find the initial mutation and whether we can find the cell who is responsible for both diseases. So this is quite a long-term project, and it still has to be granted, but we have already started the project. So we have several points like that. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Emil. Now I'd like to welcome Dr. Mazur from Israel to join us on the stage, please.
Thank you, Liz. It's a pleasure being here at Houston, and good morning to everybody, and thank you for the opportunity to speak here. My name is Roy. I'm from the Sheba Medical Center at Ramat Gan, Israel. We have a small cohort of 12 patients with a multidisciplinary service for Erdheim-Chester disease that we have established just a few years ago, and we are growing with every passing year, adding more experts and more expertise to this think tank. One of the things that we have identified is that about 30% of our patients have been diagnosed via an atypical presentation. And as such, we decided to conduct two studies. One is the radiological observational study, and the other one is the pathological study. The radiological study focuses on understanding the development and the evolution of the disease, and it's, in particular, its central nervous system involvements. We survey MRIs. We do not filter these MRIs per specific MRI machine or modality. We rather aggregate the information and try to analyze the patterns of the disease. The second study, which is, I believe, the more important one, is to try to identify and better classify the pathology of the disease. In many countries and medical centers that do not have advanced molecular capabilities, the mainstay of the pathological diagnosis relies on immunohistochemistry, which means that the specimen is sliced into thin slices and then dyed with special antibodies that are able to identify hallmark proteins that are expressed by the cells, such as CD68, which is a hallmark protein expressed in Erdheim-Chester disease. We are trying to better classify the map of proteins which might have or might not have specific roles in the disease. This is mainly an observatory study. However, we do also examine the interplay of these cells with the immune system via various proteins that are expressed on the membrane. We welcome everybody. We have, if you are ever in Israel, we have a network of medical centers that are in collaboration with us. Practically, I think every large medical center in Israel today has an ECD presence in it that is directly connected to the Sheba Medical Center, that is the Tel Aviv, Beilinson at Petah Tikva, the Kaplan at Rehovot, and Hadassah and Shari Tzedek at Jerusalem. So we are well established in that field. You are welcome to approach me with any questions. I'd love to answer. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Mazur. Now, I just take a moment to open the floor if there are any medical professionals that are out there that have any studies that they're working on that would like to share at this moment. Okay, well, with that said, first off, I just want to say how fantastic and amazing it is just to hear all of this forward progress motion that's going on in these studies. Very exciting, very impressive to a newcomer as myself. Also, I'd also like to state that if you need to get more information on these studies, that you can go to our website, and there is information about these ongoing studies there. So with that said, we're a little ahead of schedule, which is fantastic. So we're going to take about a 15-minute break and allow people to get up, walk around, stretch their legs, and then come back. And directly after that break, we're going to ask all the medical professionals that spoke just now to come and sit on our panel so that we could do a question and answer opportunity for our patients. All right. Thank you, everyone, very much. Again, everyone. So if we could begin to take our seats, we can go ahead and get started with our Q&A panel. So I'd like to welcome back all of the medical professionals that had the opportunity to speak earlier. If you could please take a seat at our panel here so we could direct some questions to you. The way we're going to do this is we're going to have two microphones for our medical professionals to be able to move back and forth amongst them. And we're going to have volunteers in the audience that will go to the people with questions with a microphone. So just raise your hand, we'll see you, we'll go over you with you with a microphone, and then just speak into that so everyone can hear your question, okay? All right, thank you.
I have two sons out there in the world somewhere, and is there any possibility that I might genetically pass this on to them, either of them?
Well, we don't know of any genes that are directly abnormal in your all the cells of your body that we would call the germline cells that you would pass on to other to your sons. So the mutation in the BRAF gene that happened in the disease is something that just happened as the disease and not something that's in your lineage, so to speak. But honestly, we haven't done any family studies to see if there are any predisposing factors that might lead to an increased chance of getting ECD. And this is a good opportunity for me to advertise a family study that we're doing for LCH, in which we're collecting DNA from parents and patients. We call it trios. We actually get spit from the parents and blood or spit from the patient. And we would welcome the ECD community to join our family study. We have collected specimens from the ECD families, but a very limited number, and it would be very interesting if we could get more patients from around the world to be part of it, because we have an ongoing study to look at genetic polymorphisms, and those are just little differences in the way a gene is spelled in your DNA versus other people's DNA, and we can compare that. So maybe someday we can answer your question, but right now it's a qualified probably not.
For those of you who have been doing trials on vemurafenib, I took it last year. I have retroperitoneal fibrosis, I'm sure like many people in the room, with my ureter being blocked. And I had the good news is it unblocked ureter, but the bad news, and this is the question, it seems to have damaged my kidney, my kidney function. Unless it's just an utter coincidence. Have you had any experience with all your trials on vemurafenib of people's kidney function being damaged?
Uh,
Not personally, but yesterday I was talking with Dr. Scheel, who is probably not here today, and he told me that he looked at the creatinine in patients taking vemurafenib, and he saw a doubling of serum creatinine, which does not progress necessarily over time, but after the start of therapy, this is what he observed. And this was not due to any obstructive disease. So it was his hypothesis is that there might be a toxicity, but I think he performed also renal biopsy in one or two cases, and there was nothing specific. So it was actually, asking other nephrologists like me if we saw the same thing. I have little experience with patients with vemurafenib, only 3-4 cases, and I didn't see anything like that. But this is his message.
We actually, I'm a cancer doctor, so I mean, I have a lot of experience with using BRAF inhibitors such as vemurafenib in cancer patients, and we don't see that in cancer patients. Although in patients with ECD, I have to say that I have anecdotally noticed actually increases in creatinine, which is a marker for kidney function. It has not reached to the point that it would be limiting in any way for the treatment administration or significantly limiting for treatment administration, but I have noticed that in ECD patients. I have to say that I don't think I have like a full understanding why it's happening in ECD and not in cancer patients, but we made a similar observation.
Yeah, Philip, I have a couple of patients who have had slight increase of creatinine levels, but it's never really an issue compared to other side effects of the drug. So this is on more than 35 patients. So it's not really a big problem for us.
I was just going to say the same thing. I've had a couple patients on vemurafenib with mild changes in the kidney function. I mean, I can only guess that, ECD patients, when you're the kidney's kind of vulnerable from the get-go, that it may be more vulnerable to a minor insult that you may not see in other diseases, but it has been mild. It's not technically, like if you look at the trial and the brochure, it's not technically really a toxicity that's meant to be attributed to the drug, but I think that in a few cases it's really hard to attribute it to anything else.
Sorry, just while we have such a fantastic panel of experts up there, I'm just wondering about the consensus document that was brought out as regards Erdheim-Chester in general, basically the document. We seem to be falling down on the actual last-ditch definition of what is ECD and whether or not it's a cancer. Everyone here probably believes it is a cancer, but from governments and from insurance companies, it's not a cancer because it's not in the definition as being a cancer. I'm just wondering, is there any plans to address that and basically to bring it as, is there a definition of what ECD is? Is it a cancer? Don't all jump in together.
Maybe. We could vote and I think it's a neoplasia. It's a proliferation, clonal proliferation related with an oncogene. So it's one of the main aspect of cancer. But I'm not so sure. I don't think the term cancer is good. I think it's neoplasia, which it's a little different. But maybe. This is the concept, but maybe for insurance, this is nothing as a concept. It's money, so we have to be careful about this.
Yeah. Well, people can call ECD whatever they want, depending on the specialty they're at. But in terms of insurance companies, what we've been doing is that we recommend to use the ICD code for malignant histiocytosis. And that doesn't say cancer, it doesn't say neoplasia, but it's a histiocytosis that it's killing the patients. So malignant histiocytosis makes sense, and that's how also ECD is classified on the World Health Organization guidelines. So that ICD code, it just changed from ICD-9 to ICD-10, and the ICD-10 code is kind of a weird number. But I remember that in the past we were recommending people to just submit everything using the 202.3 code, and that we had more success than just putting unspecified disorder. So while we make our decision whether this is a malignancy or just a benign tumor, that's the way that you should describe this to your insurance company, malignant histiocytosis.
I think that's good advice. I agree, this is an inflammatory myeloid neoplasia, and that's the words we like to use for LCH, and I think it's equally applicable for ECD. I'm a little more leaning towards the cancer side of this question for LCH, and I don't know why I shouldn't do that for ECD too, but we still are struggling with that word cancer and neoplasia, and given the mutation that's driving the disease, I think it's fair to call it a cancer, but not all my colleagues agree.
Hi. I had a kidney transplant in February 2014, and I'm on cyclosporin now. I'm just wanting to know whether any of these new drugs for ECD in the trials, do we know if there's any effect on the immunosuppressants that a transplant patient would be on now?
Regarding vemurafenib, there is no, I don't think there is any problem with the immunosuppressive, there is no side effect as immunosuppressive. Like you can have a kidney transplant and be on vemurafenib, that's what I think.
Yeah.
Regarding other, you might have problems with, for instance, treatments like that would lower your immunologic defenses, but this is not an issue with vemurafenib.
Yeah, the only comment I may add to this, which I completely agree, is that probably if you are intended to start this combination treatment, you should have an even higher level of attention of control of the exams. And also, you may be thinking that some of the side effects of vemurafenib may be a little bit more pronounced. I specifically think of the toxic effect on the skin, where probably a combined immune suppression may be rising to an increased risk of developing skin cancer. So I think that in general, and I don't know if colleagues agree with that, there are no preconcepts saying that these two treatments should not be combined. But since that would be probably one of the first time it occurs, a lot of insights and more specific attention to your case must be placed in order to have a safe treatment.
There are, for example, in my trial, there's no exclusion criteria, but there is a list of prohibitive agents or agents that you need to follow cautiously. And I know for sure that the brafenib decreases the efficacy of cyclosporin. So that is something that you need to discuss with your doctor. And we give a list of medications to all our patients, whether they are on something or they're going to start something while they're on trial. Because there's this system called a cytochrome P450 system that is the enzymatic liver thing that makes drugs work or not work. So vemurafenib decreases cyclosporin, and I believe that the brafenib increases cyclosporin, so you can go to a toxicity level. So those are things that need to be monitored closely. They may be dose dependent, but I really don't have much experience on having a patient like that. It's more just literature based. So interaction with either the function of the drug you're using increases or decreases, or whether the drug you're using decreases the efficacy of vemurafenib or dorafenib. That's what you have to discuss with your pharmacologist or someone like that. Each person that gets these drugs, they need to be, at least their medication profile needs to be seen by a pharmacologist so they can look at the interaction, especially an oncology pharmacologist.
Yeah, I think regarding this, we have the opportunity with some drugs for renal transplant, such as cyclosporin or prograf, tacrolimus or sirolimus and so on, to have the blood levels. And this must be checked when you start a new therapy,
because there can be interaction at the pharmacokinetic level, that means they can lower or increase the level of cyclosporine. But that's something easy to handle because you can modulate the dose of cyclosporine that you're taking. Another point is the drug that we have used in our trial, which is sirolimus, which is a drug commonly used in renal transplantation. I'm a renal transplant doctor, so we've used it particularly for patients that are at risk for skin cancer, for relapsing skin cancer, or patients that are at risk for any malignant disease, and they take these mTOR inhibitors. And the only advantage that has been really proved in many cases of the mTOR inhibitors versus cyclosporine or tacrolimus is that they reduce the incidence of cancer over time in renal transplant patients. This is not something that you should take like an absolute statement, because there are many combination therapies, even of cyclosporine and sirolimus or cyclosporine and everolimus. So you should discuss with your transplant doctor whether it's okay to continue this way or change therapy in case of the appearance of a malignant disease in the skin especially. So because of the combination with vemurafenib, if it's needed, as Lorenzo said, the surveillance on the skin must be very, very, very careful.
A couple questions. Once ECD has stabilized in the body, how often should you go for checkups with the MRIs and blood work and everything? And second question also, I've been on the V now for, it'll be 2 years in December, on a low dose now, but when should you take breaks from the V?
So regarding the assessment, I think that more or less a patient should be assessed like twice a year or maybe once every 9 months, depending, but I think you should take some images like TEP scan or MRI of the head if you have any other kinds of involvement. Should be done like twice a year, I believe. And regarding your treatment, you are on one pill a day right now, or you're
two?
Two. I think you should probably maintain maybe one or go to one pill a day. Or this like more depends on your response and what you've been gaining in terms of response in the last couple of months. And then there are two possibilities: either you stop the drug and you monitor and you see if you relapse and when you relapse, because it's not obvious you're going to relapse, or you start another treatment to keep the disease from coming back again, or you stay under, let's say, one pill of vemurafenib for maybe the next year to see to think over and what we're going to do after. You have many. I think you have two or three issues. Possibilities right now.
Yeah, I agree with Julian. I think the competing interests, the competing questions, are that we know that from our collective knowledge that the vemurafenib seems to work for a long time. We don't really know what happens with people who are on this for 10, 20, 30 years, so that we know one thing, we don't know the other. But we're not, like Julian said, I'd say we're not completely certain that you're going to relapse, but it's likely. But when we don't know. So those are just the parts of what we know and what we don't know. And I would say, given just from where your disease is, my approach probably would be a don't fix it if it isn't broken for now. But maybe we'll come up with other things in the future that will maintain the disease in a minimal state. The drugs that I think maintain the disease in a minimal state generally may not work as well in the brain.
So I wanted to add something, because when I was speaking just earlier today, I forgot to mention that we have a clinical trial, which is the LOVE studies, to put patients off the drug after a minimum of 6 months of treatment. So we have been including 7 or 8 patients so far with 3 or 4 relapse, with some with early relapse, but we are still in the process of analyzing, and we obviously want to have more patients to see what's going to happen. And of course, when the patient is put off the drug, he's monitored like closely for like once every 3 months. So, for instance, in a situation like this, you would not be seen like once every 6 to 9 months if you have a stabilized disease, which was one of your first questions. So that's an important issue. We want to know for sure if the patients are going to relapse or if the disease is going to maintain like in a quiescent situation for like many years, or if it's going to relapse before.
Just wanted to add a brief comment on imaging. So most of what I do is manage lymphoma, which is a group of diseases that we used to image excessively frequently. When I started doing this, we'd get scans on people every 3 months, and it's been a building body of literature that at least in those diseases, routine scans are limited to no utility. And in fact, what the patient tells the doctor is much more important than what the scan tells the doctor. And if you're feeling well, if we examine you and check your blood and everything looks stable, it's less than 2% of the time, at least in lymphoma, that a scan will tell us something that we didn't otherwise suspect. And I think in this disease, changes in scans, in my experience, have correlated relatively poorly with changes in people's symptoms. I mean, there's many times a scan will look better, people will feel worse, or vice versa. So scans, definitely important, and do it, you know, follow your physician's recommendations, but I would emphasize to always be your own best advocate, and how you're feeling often tells us much more than the scans tell us.
I just have a quick question. I wasn't sure. I mean, I only know a couple cases of ECD, but the few I heard of, diabetes insipidus has been mentioned prior to it. So I wasn't sure if you guys have found any correlation to it, if anything was involved with the ECD in that.
And the diabetes insipidus is often, I mean, if you looking at patients that we have seen in Paris, many times one of the first signs, which is found sometimes up to 30 years before, is classified as diabetes insipidus of unknown origin. So, and this is about 15% of the patients we've seen in Paris. I know this is also true in the rest of the patients. I think it's one of the first signs of the disease with other signs. And our experience is like 15% of patients present with this symptom.
No, yes, I agree with what Julian just said. Like in our cohort, at least 35% of our patients report having diabetes insipidus. There's also an interesting point that some patients don't have biochemical evidence or signs or symptoms of having diabetes insipidus, but their ADH levels are not detected when you do their assay for some reason, and they don't have the frequent urination or the excessive thirst. And now that's central diabetes insipidus. You have to differentiate between the nephrogenic form, which is totally different than the one coming from the pituitary gland. Now, how many patients out there that only have diabetes insipidus of unknown cause, like Julian said, that might have Erdheim-Chester disease that we don't know? We should just go to a registry or a center that registers people with central diabetes insipidus that they don't know why, they don't see a tumor in their MRIs or something, and try to see whether they have ECD or not. That might be an interesting study.
To be more clear, the diabetes insipidus is present in 1/3 of the patients, but it's the first sign of the disease in the 15% of the patients. And I agree on the fact that diabetes insipidus of unknown origin can be sometimes ECD, but you have lots of other more frequent condition like sarcoidosis or whatever that obviously can be.
So you don't think it like starts the disease?
What did you say?
You don't think it starts the disease then?
No. I think it's when there is, it's often one of the first signs which starts like maybe up to 30 years before the diagnosis is made. So I don't know for what reason it's like that, but.
I had a quick question, if it's okay. I was recently diagnosed with ECD about a month ago at Mayo Clinic. And they ran a PET scan on me, and I started noticing before I went to Mayo some neurological symptoms, slight balance and trouble, which I'm having now, enunciating words, and some fine motor stuff with my typing. And my Mayo hematologist ran a PET scan, and then when I got back, my Kaiser docs ran an MRI, and they both said there's no sign of neurologic involvement in the brain. And I'm wondering, then why am I having these symptoms, or is there some sort of special test you need to do to show it?
I think we're learning more and more that there are various kinds. There isn't just one kind of ECD in the brain, but there's probably many different kinds of ECD in the brain. And the story of people with sort of balance and speech problems without a clear footprint on the MRI is something that we've seen before, and so there can be that, and there can also be the phenomenon of it takes some time to declare itself on the scan. So I would say that given the earliness of your case, I would say we won't really know which that is, but there. There's also ways to look at the scans a little bit more closely and see if there's something that doesn't meet just the radiologist's eye.
Our group has recently identified a marker of LCH in the spinal fluid, and Eli and I are talking about trying to investigate the same possibility in ECD. As yet, we don't have such a marker, but I think we definitely should look.
And I would just say one last thing. I don't know if you had a dedicated PET of your brain, ma'am? I don't know if you had a dedicated... So the PET scans PET scans of the body, they actually travel to the top of the head, but they're not dedicated PET scans of the brain. Then you may see something on that if you had a dedicated PET scan.
A dedicated PET scan of the brain?
Yes.
My wife, she went out to Rapid City, South Dakota. We looked at alternative medicine for 3 years prior to getting diagnosed, and one of the clinics we went to was in Hermosa, South Dakota. When she was there, we had an episode, good, bad, or indifferent. She ended up at Rapid City ER. When we were there, treating, their best guess was high volumes of prednisone. When she was there, though, they actually picked up spots on the gray matter and the white spotting in her brain. Because we're from Rochester area, Minnesota, and Mayo Clinic's our primary, we came back and showed the information to Mayo, and it took 5 years for them to even acknowledge that there was spots there. And then it took another year and a half, 2 years to be able to diagnose the diabetes insipidus. Why is it so hard sometimes? And I'm not even coming close to trying to run down a medical facility here, but they sent us from Mayo to St. Louis to Barnes Jewish. And I know there's a couple of people that go to Mayo here, but I just don't get it. I know there's not a real answer you can give me here, but I'm trying to understand why is it so hard sometimes.
Well, from my experience with LCH, I know that many neuroradiologists are not familiar with the patterns of these diseases, and it's just a matter of experience. I mean, they're rare diseases, and unless some neuroradiologist has crossed paths with such a patient before, or read an article about it, or seen something that triggers their memory, it's a lot of things in medicine that any of us up here could be clueless about, and it's just one of those things that you have to, I guess, get lucky to find someone who recognizes the pattern.
Yeah, I do perfectly agree with that, and I think that initiatives like this one will be helping spreading this knowledge among the medical community, and we are doing our best to try to publish and to inform our colleagues about that. I would also add that one of the specific characteristics of Erdheim-Chester disease, and a number of works quite clearly suggest that, that it's a rare disease, and even if it's a more than a rare disease, it has protean clinical manifestation in every different sector. As Dr. Diamond was just saying, for example, we are now starting to understand many of the central nervous system manifestation of the disease and some clinical picture that may be somehow seen in the past and we just concluded, I don't know, now we can understand there's a kind of pattern or something similar. So it's a combination of the two. First, is definitely a rare disorder and is not common in many physicians to know it and to know the characteristic pattern. But also on the other side, it's quite common that the pattern are not that characteristic. So even if you have a high level of suspicion, you may be thinking of a specific clinical manifestation and say, is this ECD or not? So it's more easy when you have a number of different manifestations that are concurring, like Dr. Colby yesterday was saying, that are concurring to help us in making the diagnosis. But specifically, if you have just one of them, it may be extremely difficult even for a physician that knows the disease to recognize it.
So I would kind of echo that, that the awareness is number one reason why it's underdiagnosed. I mean, I can just tell a story which just happened yesterday when we were hosting the scientific part of the symposium. I actually walked out of the conference room and bumped into two of my colleagues who work at Anderson, and they saw me in the suit and tie, so they asked, what are you doing? I said, I'm hosting Erdheim-Chester Disease Symposium. They said, Erdheim what? And that's Anderson. So I think this is actually the major problem. So that's why ECD Global Alliance is critical in actually raising awareness. I mean, we're not gonna, obviously, the other challenges will remain that the manifestations can be so colorful, and not every patient is actually can be very different to some other patient, but I think this awareness is actually critical.
I guess it's still better than
Fibromyalgia 20 years ago. They sent the site for it. We're doing better than that. So. I have a question for Dr. Boston here. You mentioned about lymphoma. Is that a histiocyte? And if so, my husband was diagnosed with lymphoma, and me and ECD within a year of each other. Is there some kind of environmental factor that would make the onset of both of them?
Lymphomas and ECD come from very different types of cells, so they're very different diseases, so there's no known relation between the two. There are other histiocyte disorders, specifically one called histiocytic sarcoma, which is frequently diagnosed in the setting of other blood-related cancers, including leukemia and lymphoma. And in some settings, you can prove that both diseases originated from the same primitive blood cell. I'm not aware of any circumstances in ECD where that's been the case. I'm seeing a lot of head shaking in the negative as well. So it's certainly interesting that both diseases would be diagnosed within a short period of time. But as far as we know, there's no link between the two.
Thank you.
So my fiance was diagnosed 3 years ago, actually this month. And he's experiencing those CNS symptoms that have been described by a couple of other folks. And he has had MRIs. We live in a real small village in southwest New Hampshire. So we're only about two hours north of Boston and about 2 hours south of Dartmouth-Hitchcock, which is where his provider is. He's actually a rheumatologist. And he presented with a myriad of symptoms, and our gastroenterologist is the one that actually conferred with Dr. Scheel and Now's Now. So the CNS symptoms, with the MRIs being negative, and I think Dr. Diamond, you had said that, or one of the providers up there, I apologize, said that perhaps it's just not presenting yet. But he's 3 years in. Is it possible that they are presenting and they're not being seen? Is it in our or his best interest to go further and have someone else take a look at that? Right now, there's only one set of eyes following him.
I think it's, I mean, as a dogma, in my opinion, it's always good to have an experienced ECD person be a second set of eyes on a case, you know, whether there's a hanging question or not, and certainly if there is. With regards to what I said about sort of brain changes declaring themselves over time, I would agree that 3 years is a long time to have a quote-unquote normal scan. I think the question in this case is really what are the deficits, what's the examination, you know, where in the nervous system do we point our finger at and take a very close look there and see if it's really normal or not, and see if we can find another culprit to explain it. Or if there isn't a lesion, like a tumor, but if that area is shrunken, which is another possibility, which could be a manifestation of ECD.
He's currently being treated with daily injections of anakinra and just 5 milligrams maintenance of prednisone. That's the only two drugs he's being treated specifically for ECD. And we trialed an every other day injection of the Kineret, of the anakinra, and his blood markers went right back up. So we're back on every day. He feels good. The rheumatologist that's treating him says you're stable. But I'm left getting a little nervous because I feel like there may be something else going on. His balance is still off. His speech, the lady that had commented earlier about her speech, his speech is declining and we're all noticing it. So those are the types of things that have me concerned, that we're missing something.
So I think if anakinra is actually not giving him enough symptom control, it might be actually reasonable to consider what other options are there. I mean, if there is a BRAF mutation testing, and if BRAF mutation is there, then actually vemurafenib or some other BRAF inhibitors would be a good option. They also actually do penetrate to the brain, so even if there is some disease involvement of the brain, which we just failed to see on the MRI, they actually do. BRAF targeting drugs can help with that because they are actually supposed to get to the brain. So that's actually something which might be considered if we don't know genomic of his disease yet.
One other aspect of having another set of eyes look at the scans is to make sure that the MRI was done properly, because there are different ways the MRI is calibrated. We call them sequences, and there are certain sequences which show the neurodegenerative condition better than others. So unless your husband had all of those specific sequences, it could be missed, because there are some of the ways the MRI is done that just look at for tumors in the brain and don't show this neurodegenerative change very well. So I would say that would be another reason for getting a second opinion.
And I'll just make a plug that ECD patients with unexplained neurologic symptoms are really a gold mine of learning opportunity for all of us, and there's a lot of testing that we can do which may seem like research now, but it may not be research later. So I would say that you can help us and everyone if you can get a specialist to have an eye on the case.
Thank you for being so accessible to all of us in those questions. Not all diseases have this opportunity, I think. So, thank you. I have a question regarding the bladder. I'm not the patient, so when I talk about the prostate, you understand why. There isn't really much research. It's been lightly, you know, you see a little bit about bladder outside the ureters and the kidneys, how the urethra, the bladder, prostate, and how hormones are all involved with ECD has been a mystery to us. And have you seen anybody else with that kind of presentation?
Who specifically for even for prostate or for bladder or for? Yeah, I have two patients, I think, with involvement of the bladder. I don't have any recollection of prostate. Usually it's really the kidney and the ureters coming out of the kidneys, but not really the bladder.
In our experience, we have one patient that has problems with the bladder, but it's not because there's fibrosis in his bladder. He has disease in the spinal cord, and it's causing the nerves that go to the bladder. So that may be another. It's not as common to have spinal cord involvement in ECD, but it's a possibility. So that's another way that it can present, but that's the one experience that we have with bladder issues.
Just, and the other possibility that the bladder could be affected, you can, if you have disease in the area sort of in front of the sacrum, behind the bladder, the soft tissues there, that could affect bladder function, but not be not have direct involvement of the bladder per se.
One of the things which might be perhaps a little bit long shot, but also depending on what therapy is on, some therapies actually reduce immunity. So I mean, the problem might be also frequent urinary tract infections, which obviously also affect the bladder function in some way. Usually in terms of urgencies and these type of things, but that's...
But what are the specific symptoms? It's a difficulty in voiding, or it's pain during...
Urgency.
I can tell you from my experience with patients with retroperitoneal fibrosis, which is not related to Erdheim-Chester, that frequency is a frequent symptom. Although this is not related to infection nor to nerve involvement or any kind of thing. But you have to consider that many veins that come out of the bladder and all the little pelvis go up and can be encased by the fibrosis that is around the ureters and the kidneys. So although there is no direct infiltration of the bladder or the prostate, there might be other systems of collection of blood that can be impaired by the fibrosis that is up.
I have a question. A gentleman a few minutes ago mentioned fibromyalgia, and for years and years people thought that there was just an imagination in a woman's mind. And Iris had doctors told her she had fibromyalgia, but now she has the ECD. And in the histories of a lot of your patients, have you noticed that they've said they had been diagnosed with fibromyalgia in the past? Maybe that disease is related to this.
It's quite a difficult question, because actually it's fibromyalgia as a disease, as a quite complex, let's say, nosography, which means that it's complex to be properly diagnosed. And fibromyalgia in general is a condition that is quite paradoxically, in some instances, overdiagnosed, and in other instances is underdiagnosed. Fibromyalgia means actually that it's a pain syndrome when the patient is reporting pain. And one of the criteria for the diagnosis is that you ascertain that there's no other causes for that specific pain. So in that specific case, I quite think that the diagnosis of fibromyalgia was a kind of mistake. I mean, the physician taking care of the patient weren't able to find another explanation for those pain, and then they interpret the clinical picture as fibromyalgia. And this is happening quite often, not only and not specifically in ECD, but it's happening in a number of syndromes that are characterized by pain, where the immediate origin of pain is not that immediate. So I'm not saying that the physician went wrong, but the physician weren't able to find any specific explanation for that, quite quickly, maybe too quickly, concluded for fibromyalgia.
Yeah, I hear this story all the time, and I think it's unfortunately, when a physician is faced with a complex problem and they don't have the answer, sometimes fibromyalgia kind of covers the waterfront and is an easy diagnosis. But you mentioned, it's very complex to make the diagnosis, and it's easy to, I think, overdiagnose it. So in the context of a patient with pain, you really have to dig pretty deeply to get the right answer.
Actually, for some doctors in France and I think elsewhere, fibromyalgia is something that does not exist. Like, some people come and visit me for, you know, they say I have pain, and some doctors told me I had fibromyalgia. I say, I don't know what fibromyalgia is. They just say you have pains, like in several, you know, bone pains or pains in the articulations, but the concept itself is something very vague, and like many physicians want to say, you know, without really thinking, you have fibromyalgia. But personally, I don't know what fibromyalgia is. I think like people have pain, and that's just a symptom, like pointed out by my colleagues.
Just a question. There's a lot of people on BRAF inhibitors at this stage. I think Dr. Roche said he had about 40 on BRAF, and there's quite a lot on there. Are there any guidelines as to how long people should stay on them, or what are the clinical signs where you've reached your maximum level of getting to where it's then time to stop or give it a break? Or what is the situation there? Are there clinical tests that you need to, so is your last set of scans showing those improvements on the previous set of scans, is that a sign that you should stop? What's the sign?
I think the patients are too different from one case to another to try to give you a unique and simple answer. But I would probably say first it depends of for what you're treated, and then many things that you're looking, the metabolic answer on the PET scan, the shrinking of various infiltrations, like if you had a heart tumor, if it disappears on the heart MRI, or if it gets to a minimum infiltration, and then if it doesn't start, if it does not continue to regress, a couple of blood tests like CRP value if you have no inflammatory syndrome anymore, and of course the clinics and the tolerance of the drug. So then if you are, let's say, after 1 year of treatment and you have no signs of a disease whatsoever with a regression of all the fibrosis around the aorta, around the kidney, and you have a normal MRI of your head and a PET CT which is negative, then you could, and that you have no signs of the disease, no bone pain or whatever, then you could probably put you at the minimum dose for, I'd say, a year and a half, 2 years. And then after 2 years, I haven't personally kept on the drug after 2 years, and then I propose to the patients to start the love study to see what happens when the disease, when you are off the drug, and if you're going to relapse or not. That was one of the questions we wanted to answer. But so it's very difficult to give you an answer, a unique answer, but that's, we're trying to adapt to why were the patient treated, and has he responded, and how far, and does the infiltration around the various aorta, the various organs, is keeping on regressing, and after we discuss with you, and then we propose either to continue or to stop the treatment.
There are unfortunately so many kind of layers of decision making and so many factors which complicate the decision, because like often in patients you see initial regression, but then there is no more regression in fibrosis, which may never go away, because even if all the histiocytes actually disappear, I mean the fibrosis might actually still stay there to certain point. So I can see the downside and upside actually with all approach, and we don't know, and hopefully the studies like last study will actually give us some answer in that regard.
Yeah, I agree with what Julian's saying. I think so. Every person, every patient's different because their sort of constellation of organs and how sick they are is different. But I think that when you've been on the drug for long enough to know that you've kind of landed, meaning your scans aren't changing and you're clinically not changing, I think that's the time that it's worth asking the question and then sort of thinking it out in the way that Julian said.
I would say it's probably every month is probably a good interval, especially in the beginning because you have to check your liver enzymes, for instance, and you get an electrocardiogram for the QT interval, and as you have to see your dermatologist and all that stuff, you should probably get a blood test like once every month. It seems a good interval. Perhaps after maybe 1 year, you could put it to 2 months, but I do not personally. I still recommend like once every month. I don't know if my colleagues do the same. Yeah. Okay.
Will you please address changes in a sensitive area for a lot of patients? Hypogonadism, testosterone, libido fatigue. What's going on? And is treatment directly towards the disease the answer? Should people be getting testosterone replacement? What do they do? Because nobody wants to talk about it.
You mean on the endocrine aspects of the disease? It's obvious that there is not only diabetes insipidus. There are all the glands that can be affected, and you can have hypogonadism. You can have adrenal problems. You can have the another part of the hypothalamus that can be affected, and you have a lot of endocrine disorder, which for someone who's not a specialist, I'm not an endocrinologist, is very complicated to and you also have thyroid problems and. And it's very complicated, and I think that each patient who has ECD should be evaluated or assessed like once every 6 months or once every year by someone who's an endocrinologist. So I believe that some of the aspects of the disease, if you are under BRAF inhibitor or actually any kind of treatment for ECD, some of those aspects are getting improved and better if you have less disease in your body due to a treatment that's efficacious. But some of the deficits are permanent, like diabetes insipidus, for some strange reason, and not only in ECD but in various diseases, is permanent. So you have to get the substitution for a lifetime. And some of other deficits can get better, but this is too specialized for me. I'm being helped in PTSL-Petria by endocrinology department, and all the patients that I see are referred to an endocrinologist. I think Augusto, you want to?
Actually, I think your question was more on the hypogonadism or was it endocrinological in general? If you have to use like testosterone therapy, are you interested in that or I misunderstood? Okay.
Address it all.
Because we at our center, we have a tradition of endocrinologists that give testosterone to everybody. Like they had a research area in terms of low testosterone levels in geriatric patients, so in elderly men, and they use testosterone a lot. So when we refer patients to them and they have some kind of hypogonadism, they usually receive this therapy. And I have to say that a couple of them really improved, not only in terms of sexual function or whatever, but also in terms of muscle strength and, you know, energy in general. So it's kind of an anabolic response. So it makes you eat more, feel better generally. So if I see that there is a low testosterone level that depends most likely from a Erdheim-Chester, you treat a Erdheim-Chester, of course, but you can give replacement therapy with hormones. And I have to say that I've seen two cases of diabetes insipidus that went away. One was a patient that Jean-François diagnosed as an LCH plus ECD. And another man, and after 7 or 8 years of disease, I mean of full blown histiocytosis, they no longer take the minirin.
About the hypogonadism, so I screen all male ECD patients, and I would say that not all, but close to all, have low testosterone levels, and I think that then leads to two questions. One is, where does it come from? And it can be from here. I think there's also underestimated incidence of actually testicular ECD. So, and you can sort that out with labs, whether it's coming from the brain or whether it's coming from the testes themselves. So that's one question. And the other question is it really symptomatic? Because for people who are ill, fatigue and low libido is not necessarily a function of low testosterone. So I think you can try to sort that out, and you try to treat those symptoms, and then depending on the age and other medical problems of the patient, you can decide whether you want to do testosterone replacement or symptomatic management.
The endocrine part of the disease is more complex than that, and we have had many patients that come with different levels in their endocrine profiles. We test every single hormone available in the body. Thankfully, we have the staff of NITDK, which is the Endocrine Institute at the NIH, that's going to be looking at the data of all the patients that have come through the NIH, and they're going to let us know how to make sense out of it. But in terms of not just diabetes insipidus or the hypogonadism and the thyroid dysfunctions, there are other things that are coming in the picture. Now, ECD is being diagnosed in patients that are young, and they might be in their reproductive age. So replacing a man with hypogonadism with regular testosterone should be discussed further, because that causes atrophy and meiosis there, doesn't produce a good sperm. So that's going to be a problem. The same thing with a female that is not having ovulation because she has hypogonadism secondary to the disease. So we have an OBGYN looking into that aspect of the disorder, which have not yet been described. There is a lot of information, because we've seen patients with prolactin secretion, but they're not having any breast milk development or anything like that. And also the thyroid problems can come from three different ways. You can have central hypothyroidism, which some of our patients have it, or you can have a autoantibody developed by any other reason. We've seen that in many patients with ECD. And also some kinase inhibitors can have thyroid dysfunction as a side effect, so you can end up having an endocrinopathy because of your therapy. So it's always good to look not just to replace that hormone, and testosterone is the big deal here, so just don't order a total testosterone. Tell them to do the free testosterone, and if it's possible, to do all the other androgens down the pathway, because there might be other ways of replacement. And there's get just an endocrinologist that is really interested in pituitary function to get involved. So hopefully we'll have some answers with what our endocrinologists will do or look at.
I think anyway, she's right in saying that this is something nobody talks about, and if you tell a patient, if you feel more tired or if you have a sexual dysfunction, you need to ask deeply and to put yourself in a condition where the patient is confident and is at ease and can tell things. So I think it needs to be really investigated, and in patients above 50 years, 45, 50 years, I think that replacement therapy can really help.
In terms of whether a BRAF inhibitor can stop the disease or the endocrine deficit, it's not a primary endpoint in our trial, but we've noticed that two of our patients, their ADH levels and inclusive their testosterone levels are up and down, so we have been adjusting a lot the dose of those replacements while they're on therapy. Before, like, one of them needed to use the antidiuretic hormone every day, and there are sometimes that he doesn't need a dose until 4 days. So that's something that I don't know if it's associated with the drug or what's going on, or he's been too positive and he really didn't need that much drug before. So something that we're keeping an eye on now on the patients.
So I just want to give we're at the five-minute cue right before lunch for everyone. So we really only probably have time for one or two burning questions. And I'm sure if there's anything that's just left lingering, perhaps some of the doctors might be able to address some of this during lunch. I want to just interrupt quickly. We have a question for our panel for a patient that could not be here today. So I'm just going to read on their behalf. And then I'll, after that, they answer that question, we'll open up to one or two more questions. So they say, I have issues with low vitamin D levels been found, or I'm sorry, have issues with low vitamin D levels been found with ECD patients. There have been a number of patients in the ECDGA that have discovered that they have low vitamin D. In at least one patient during the verminafinib, the use of vitamin D tablets has significantly reduced leg bone pain. Has this phenomenon been observed in any of the trials or by any of the treating doctors?
Sorry, vitamin D deficiencies are pretty common amongst Caucasians, especially in the U.S. So it depends also on the age they are, if they're having osteoporosis, which is not really associated with the disease that I'm aware of, but it's pretty common. And we have seen also that not just the bone pain gets better when you start doing the replacements, also some central nervous system signs and symptoms get better in a few of them. And not only vitamin D, like Eli was saying, that there are other vitamin deficiencies. Vitamin B12 is really important in these people. And even though you might have a normal level of vitamin B12, I would encourage them to get an MMA level to make sure that they don't have some sort of demyelination process that might be making their CNS health worse.
My wife has been on Kineret for 5 years going on. Was diagnosed through the rheumatoid up at Mayo, and they got her down to Dr. Gabbati at Barnes Jewish to start the BRAF gene or trial, the drug. Is there any known documentation of long-term use of either one of those, or especially the Kineret, or the combination of the two, or does she need to be on the Kineret yet? Can she just go to the one drug? Or I guess that's the question, is you look at the Kineret, she's been on it 5 years, does she still need to be on it if she's on the drug trial?
I mean, when it comes to Kineret, actually, that's been used long-term for some patients with rheumatoid arthritis, although it's a kind of a medication which is being kind of pushed away a little bit from the rheumatoid arthritis arena. But so far as we know, there don't seem to be any long-term downside of being on Kineret. When it comes to vemurafenib, I mean, we don't really know. Cancer patients are not on that long. So I think that's something which we will need. Cancer patients on average are on vemurafenib really for several months. Well, if you have outliers, they might be on that for very few years. So the ECD population in that regard is different. So, I mean, what is the risk of the long-term use of vemurafenib? I think we will ultimately learn in the years to come. When it comes to whether she needs both drugs together, I mean, that's more kind of like a, unfortunately, clinical judgment decision, because I don't think we have actually any data to guide us in that regard. Although my kind of feel would be that if there is no kind of any significant inflammatory component, then maybe there is not too much point to be on Kineret at the same time as she's on vemurafenib, providing she's responding to vemurafenib.
I think she. You also need to know whether it was a true rheumatoid arthritis or not. One clue could be if she was she had positive autoantibodies of rheumatoid arthritis, like anti-CCP or rheumatoid factor. In that case, the diagnosis is you know, it's safer. Otherwise, it could be even a manifestation of the disease that she had joint pain or swelling sometimes. So if she was a true seropositive rheumatoid arthritis, maybe the treatment options can be different as compared to a case of pure rheumatic pain in the hands associated with Erdheim-Chester. So I think you need to be sure that the diagnosis was that and was not something related to Erdheim-Chester.
I think normally in my experience, the symptoms that are managed by the anakinra well, which is to say, you know, bone pain, feeling crummy, usually the VEM works for that as well, so I wouldn't think you would need to be on both, but I've heard of patients who switched from one to the other, you know, felt like they felt better and still with in those respects with the kinra, and it was added back. So I think it's a matter of what the kinra was doing symptomatically and whether the vemurafenib solved the problem or not.
Yeah, my point is that definitely I agree with what our colleague said. We have to quite clarify if there's a coexistence of the two diagnoses. Since rheumatoid arthritis has a general prevalence in the general population of roughly 1%, we can expect a casual combination of two diseases. So if this is present, you may be needing to take proper medication for either diseases. And I mean, I'm a rheumatologist also, so I can advise on that, but definitely you should be thinking of treating Erdheim-Chester on one side and treating rheumatoid arthritis on the other one. And probably you may be also considering other drugs than anakinra if it's needed for rheumatoid and if vemurafenib is needed for the treatment of Erdheim-Chester. But I think the major point is to be sure that, as colleagues said, those pains were not just a misdiagnosis of rheumatoid in light of the later diagnosis of ECD.
Although I have to say, going back to what I say, I mean, we do actually have experience with patients who have both conditions, RA and ECD. So, I mean, that's kind of like really critical. If there is really truly rheumatoid, then obviously stopping kinetet would probably make her miserable, especially since vemurafenib can also cause joint pain. So that's kind of a key issue. I mean, is there really rheumatoid arthritis or not?
The important thing is to know if there is erosion of the cartilage. But it's beside the antibodies, the important is to know if I have destruction of the cartilage or not on the simple radiographies or an echography.
My wife has had ECD and has had cerebellar as well as some brainstem lesions, and I was just wondering, she's on verapamil, and was just wondering, you know, in terms of follow-up MRIs, whether the experience of most people is that they will see those lesions totally disappear, or if there'll be like residual scarring or something like that that you might still detect on the MRI even after they are in remission.
So for cerebellar lesions on vemurafenib, I would say many will resolve completely on the scans that show the contrast. On some of the other scans, you'll probably see some degree of scarring. So you'll see, depending on the dose people are able to tolerate, you'll see a resolution of the lion's share of it, but there's usually some you know, footprint that it was there, and usually the symptoms that developed first will probably be the last to resolve and may not resolve 100%, but should get better.
All right. Well, thank you, everyone, for your questions. That was great. And thanks. Let's give our presenters a round, warm round of applause. All right. So thank you very much. So we are going to be breaking for lunch. However, just a moment. We all need to meet downstairs and outside for a group photo. This should only take as quickly as it takes us to shuffle downstairs. So let's go ahead and get that done, and then we can go ahead and